good morning, everybody. Good morning, Secretary General. Haven't had a chance to say formally how nice it is to be here in Kingston once more and with you all to discuss this environmental management plan that we hope to be able to implement at some stage in the future and to make sure it's done in the best possible way and with the best buy-in from all the interested parties as well from this. You said that the LTC was the engine. The LTC couldn't possibly function without fuel, which is the Secretariat. And of course, whatever the engine is in the car and its direction and where it's got to head towards is what the council does. So all parts are very important to make sure we head in the right direction. And of course, you yourself are the driver. So you can tell us where we've got to head towards and make sure we get there. So first of all, it's with great apologies that Elva Escobar, who was going to give this talk, can't be with us. She would have very much liked to have been here, and we would have liked to have had her here, both for her knowledge and input, but also for her social abilities and for keeping us all happy at the same time. So it's a great loss that we do that. And I have to apologize that for the late start of this meeting, in that having put together a presentation in place of Elva, I wanted to make sure that the rest of the LTC members also knew about what was going to be said and had agreed or knew basically where they might want to add some things in. And at the same time, obviously, it's helped fill in the gap while Craig is found somewhere in Kingston and is brought down to the meeting. So it's very good to see you here as well. So I'm just filling in time, you know, give you a chance to get together. Okay, so what I hope to go through in just a few slides is some of the sort of background to why we're here today and with the groups of people that we have. So can I go forward? Yeah. So this is from the geological model that's been issued by the International Seabed Authority and shows just the vastness of this huge area that is under discussion today. For me, that comes from the Atlantic. I always try and remind myself that the area that we're talking about is as wide as the Atlantic. It's as wide as half of the Pacific. It's a huge, huge area. And each of the contractors that have been hard at work in these areas, or parts of this area, have been doing a lot of excellent work. But there has been very little in the way of integration of all of these inputs together with other scientific programs. And that is something that is of concern to the Legal and Technical Commission. There have been some contractors getting together in small groups, but we don't seem to have a way of getting all this information together about the region. And if we're going to really come up with a sensible environmental plan based on what we do know, but also taking into account what we don't know, and we don't do this at a regional scale, then we won't succeed. So what we're trying to put into place here is the best environmental plan that we can at a regional scale that safeguards biodiversity across the region in order to allow the real exploitation of resources in that area in a controlled way. I think we need to, you know, realize why we're here. We're a part of the International Seabed Authority. The International Seabed Authority, for the benefit of all nations, is charged with actually going and finding resources and exploiting those resources. And we want to be able to do that in the best possible way. So it's a balance between exploitation of resources and at the same time having a sensible plan for the conservation of biodiversity in the environment for the future. Now, the rest of the Legal and Technical Commission can interrupt at any stage. If they disagree or agree, please do so. The background to this is that ever since a workshop that was held by Professor Craig Smith at the University of Hawaii in Manila on what could be done for a regional scale management plan, that was held in October 2007, the Legal and Technical Commission have been considering this plan and have raised various questions about it, and have also made some suggestions about how it might be better managed, and in quite a dynamic way also with the Secretariat here at the ISA. So in 2008 we had a presentation by Professor Smith here at the ISA, and from that quite a number of discussions and questions and issues were raised by the ISA that needed further discussion, and we took that through to our discussions in 2009, particularly looking at the legal considerations and also looking at the various environmental issues. And last year we didn't get very far because of the Icelandic volcano, which meant that lots of people couldn't get into Kingston quickly enough. But one of the things we did resolve from that was that we needed a far better and much broader base of interests and advice and buy-in, if you like, to the plan than we had been able to achieve so far. And that was a requirement to try and organize this workshop in order to bring this critical group together. And that's where we're at for this workshop. So as the Secretary General has said, slightly just rewritten, these are the major aims of the workshop. We want to review the proposal that Craig has already put together, and he'll be doing that in a few moments. We want to identify other data that are available, particularly from the contractors, and that's the reason why we have all the talks from the contractors, because we want to see whether this information helps support, or we want to use that information to amend the plan that we have before us. But by doing that, we have everyone also contributing. And we need to then advise the authority on how it might go about formulating this particular plan. And as part of that, it will go forward, really, and it's not just about the Clarion-Clipperton zone. It is how we go ahead and manage the environment throughout the area and how the authority might go ahead and do that, because this won't be the final thing we have to talk about. There'll be lots of other issues to do with the environment to talk about in the future. So it's important we get this right at the start at the same time. The general principles of what we're trying to do is to make sure that we protect the biodiversity, the natural ecosystem structure throughout the area of the Clarion-Clipperton zone. And it's not just about how many species and where they are, it's about how they interact and how the whole ecosystem functions. So we're trying to make sure that whatever plan we have at a regional scale addresses both of these. As part of that, there is absolutely no way we can get over the fact that from the mining procedures, there will be significant impacts on the seabed and on the fauna within it. And so we have to sort of, if you like, take that on the chin, but we have to have a sensible plan that will allow the remediation, the recolonization of those impacted areas subsequently. And that's also what this environmental plan is aimed to try and do. We want to obviously avoid conflict with any existing uses and claims within the area. And it's not that this plan, once formed, will never be changed. We think that basically, based on new information, that it should be reviewed. And so periodic reviews based on the latest scientific information and research should be allowed for in what we do. It must obviously be consistent with international law and also within the legal framework of the authority, which we'll hear a talk about today, and be consistent, as we will see from other talks, with whole ecosystem management. We're not just talking about mining. Mining has got to be set within the context of all the other pressures that may be occurring in the marine environment from other industries, in other areas perhaps, but also from climate change. And we have to take all these potential impacts into account. What are the advantages? Well, the advantages, I think that first of all, the International Seabed Authority will be seen to be being proactive about the proper environmental management of its area, that it knows it wants to exploit resources, but it wants to do this in an environmentally responsible and sustainable way. So there's great advantage in making a plan now before there has been any impact. Apparently doesn't happen in any other industrial fora, but we need to make sure that we also get the benefit of being seen to be putting together a good plan. out of that may come that we will avoid, as certainly as contractors and the Seabed Authority, of avoiding any costly litigation or interruptions to the procedures and operations that may come through the courts. I think if you have a good plan, then there's less likely that this is going to happen. And we can see that, say, if with an environmental disaster or whatever, what can happen in the Gulf of Mexico. And so we want to try and avoid, obviously, that as much as possible. One also should obviously be aware that, apart from preserving biodiversity, you're also preserving the option of other resources that may occur in the area, and in particular, genetic resources, or blue technology, as it's being called. And hopefully, from the advantages of working together, there will also be greater awareness and greater data sharing between contractors and others to aid everyone's work. So finally, just two slides. One on what we think should be the outputs from this workshop. First of all, we need to generate text. We need words. Words are needed to put together a regional management plan, and coming out of the three subgroups that the Secretariat have identified, because what we would like to see is a document submitted to the Legal and Technical Commission next year, if at all possible. There may be other things that don't allow that to happen, but that would be a good outcome from this, for the Legal and Technical Commission to be able to consider this at its meeting next July, next year, and from that, potentially, to be able to recommend to the Council the particular plan based on the best available knowledge for the law and for the environment and practical application. Then it goes into the world of politics of the Council, and well, who knows what will come from that. I was going to ask before I started whether the Secretariat were hoping that from this meeting a report would be written of all the papers presented and the discussions held, which presumably will come out as a technical, maybe a part of the technical series, as other workshops have done. So all the work that we do here will also be published and be freely available. And we will obviously want to move not just to paper and have a paper park, but actually to put this plan into action for the future. The other, obviously, the advantages of this workshop will be that hopefully it will create greater awareness between contractors about what everyone is doing, and also the best practices that can be used these days to get environmental data. And finally, I think one of the issues really is to try and raise awareness of the work of the International Seabed Authority in the wider world, and through this type of proactive plan on the environment, and using many of the images that contractors and others are collecting, I believe that through targeted press releases and such things, we can publicize the work of the International Seabed Authority and raise its exposure, if you like, in the world and people wanting to know about this type of work. Okay, does anybody else from the Legal and Technical Commission wish to add anything? Are there any other comments? Are there any questions? Craig.
Just had a comment. One comment is that the ISA, International Seabed Authority, and its environmental regulations and planning are actually serving as a model for a variety of countries and how they manage the environmental impacts of human activities. For example, Papua New Guinea is using a lot of the basic guidelines that ISA has come up with. So ISA is serving as an example and a role model for much of the world. So I think it's what is done here is of significance beyond the area, but also into national jurisdictions.
That is true. I think we have not only been able to influence things like that, but also we have a lot to learn from what's happening in Papua New Guinea as well, and we will hopefully know more about that during this meeting. Okay, if we want coffee, then we're almost on time. So, Mr. Chairman, okay.
I'm like a man who's got his priorities straight. We'll have one more presentation and then we'll be breaking for coffee. This next presentation is by Dr. Craig Smith, and I think everybody who has been paying any attention recognizes he's one of the leading authorities on the benthic environment in the area. So without further ado, Dr. Smith. Oh, just got to get him wired up. Half a second.
Never came, so there were a number of us who unfortunately were not here on time. Not that, yeah, I don't know if you can see this. What I'm going to do is give a presentation on the recommendations that we developed at a workshop for a series of protected areas. Now they're being called areas of particular environmental interest for ecosystem-based management of the Clarion-Clipperton zone. And again, these are rationales and recommendations to the International Seabed Authority from a workshop that we had in 2007 that was sponsored by a variety of organizations, including the Pew. Most of the funding came from the Pew Foundation for Marine Conservation, but also from ISA and other sources. And this is the collective wisdom of quite a number of international experts, 20 international experts, including marine geologists, conservation biologists, fisheries biologists, biological oceanographers, physical oceanographers. So these recommendations are based on the work of a lot of very smart people, much smarter than I am, who have spending a lot of time thinking about, number one, marine conservation and marine environmental management in the context of mining in the Clipperton Clarion zone here. So these are these are not my recommendations. These are the recommendations from a broad group of international experts. I also want to apologize. I'm jet-lagged, as many of us are. My body time is somewhere like 3 in the morning, so I'm having trouble connecting words with thoughts. So please bear with me. Okay, so these are the recommendations that I'm going to present. And just to put this in context, marine protected areas are used widely in ecosystem-based management, environmental management plans, such as one that we're tasked with coming up with for the CCZ. They're designed to protect biodiversity, ecosystem functions and services, sustainability of resources, in particular biological resources, in the presence of a variety of human activities, including fishing, oil drilling, mining, and other human impacts. And in fact, the science of marine protected area design and its application are quite well developed. There are now well over 100 marine protected areas globally that have been developed and studied in the marine environment. And so we know quite a bit. There's quite a bit of wisdom about how to design these and how to set them up and use them. And one thing that is I think, that the whole group recognized was critically important was to apply this knowledge about protected area design before extractive activities begin in the deep sea in the area managed by the International Seabed Authority, particularly for nodule mining. And it's important to set up this environmental management plan, which we think should include marine protected areas, before extractive activities begin. But also, I don't know how to get rid of this. Maybe I can get rid of it like this. But also before the coverage of claims becomes so extensive that effective siting of marine protected areas is precluded. If too much of the area is taken up with claims, then it's not possible, may not be possible to set up an effective marine protected area network without infringing on claims. Now, what I'm going to do is start with a workshop outcome. I'm going to start with the conclusions and then show you what our recommendations are and then explain how we got to these conclusions so that you see where we're going right from the beginning. Now, what the workshop recommended is that we divide the Clipperton Clarion Zone into 9 ecological subregions. Is it possible? It looks like there's a light on the screen here. It's kind of hard to see. Is it possible to turn one of these lights, turn that one off? Yeah, that Can't turn that off? Yeah, the light back there is shining on the screen. I think it's hard for people to see. Yeah. Yeah. That's much better. Can people see better now? Okay. What we recommended is that we divide the Clipperton and Clarion zone into 9 ecological subregions, each with a 400 by 400 square kilometer protected area or area of particular environmental interest in each of these 9 subregions. And that these 9 subregions, these I don't know how to pronounce this, but APIs, we'll call them APIs or protected areas, are integrated into the current exploration mining claim framework. They're situated so they don't overlap existing mining claims. And they cover roughly 30% of the management area. The management area is the whole area within this larger box. And based on a variety of studies, empirical and modeling studies, protecting 30% or more of a management area optimizes the conservation benefits from a variety of perspectives, including protection of biodiversity, sustainable production of biological productivity or biomass and in a region, et cetera. So this is a 30% in protected areas is a common goal in environmental management plans now. And one thing to point out is that our recommendations are that these locations of these APs or protected areas within each subregion are flexible. They're subject to negotiation amongst the various claim holders, allowing adaptive management. And we ideally would like to see a plan come up with locating these at particular locations now or in the near future. But these could be modified as we learn more about the environment, as more mining claims come in, et cetera, as long as the basic framework of protecting a 400 by 400 square kilometer area in each of these 9 subregions is preserved. So there is flexibility, and there is a concept of adaptive management being built into this. If this plan or this protected area scheme changes as we learn, can be changed as we learn more about the environment. Okay, how did we arrive at these recommendations? Well, we started with a reasonable set of assumptions concerning mining impacts and the CCZ ecology and biogeography. And then we applied 8 guidelines and rationales based on from the Seabed Authority's own guidelines and also conservation biology. So let me go through these assumptions first, because they're pretty important in terms of generating a region-wide environmental management plan. The first assumption is that mining will affect large areas of the seafloor due to direct disturbance, on the order of 300 to 600 kilometers per year directly disturbed by a mining head as it removes nodules, and also due to sediment plumes. That sediment plumes inevitably will be generated, and they are likely to have disturbance effects on scales of tens of kilometers from the immediate location of the mining operation. And given the heterogeneous distribution of nodules, of the resources within each of these claim areas, they're distributed on scales of 1 to 10 kilometers in patches that are separated by scales of 1 to 10 or 20 kilometers. It's very reasonable to assume that over a 15-year mining operation, any location within a 75,000 kilometer squared claim area has the potential to be impacted by mining. We can't a priori assume that anywhere within a claim area itself, when it's mined, will not be impacted. So we have to manage the region as though each claim area is potentially lost to biodiversity and ecosystem function. Another assumption is that benthic ecosystem recovery will be slow. And we require on the order of decades or more for the soft sediment community structure and function. And when there are lots of data that are consistent with this, quite a few environmental studies, and obviously don't have time to go through them here. But to just give you an example of how fragile this environment is and how long it takes for the ecosystem structure to recover, this is an example of a mining track that was created by OMCO test mining. It's a 1.5 meters wide, 10 centimeters deep, and it looks pretty fresh. If I came across this track like this in a fragile ecosystem, like a desert ecosystem. I would say it's, what, a few weeks old, a month old? In fact, it's 26 years old. So this gives you an idea of the time scale of recovery of the habitat structure in the soft sediment system in the Clipperton Clarion Zone. It's going to take decades for the structure, habitat structure and function within the soft sediment system to recover. And it actually will take much longer for the nodule, the hard substrate, the nodule habitats. The nodules have, it's not well documented, they have a separate fauna, a specialized fauna that lives on the nodules and not in the sediments. And they require the hard substrate of nodules to live. And with mining, we'll remove this hard substrate. This hard substrate takes millions of years to regenerate. Nodules grow very slowly. So at least for thousands, on the order of thousands of years or more, we can assume that there will be an impact, sustained impact, on the nodule fauna within a particular mining claim area. So, whoops. Oh, man. My fingers are jet-lagged, too, just like my brain. I apologize. So we can conclude that over time scales of benthic ecosystem discovery, decades to millennia, there's a good potential that all the current mining claims will be impacted by mining. Even though each claim will only be mined for 15 years, by the time one claim area is mined and recovered after 1,000 years, the other claim areas are also likely to have been mined. So we need to manage the environmental impacts of this area, this region as a whole, as though it's simultaneous, because it will, in essence, there will be simultaneous environmental impact from mining on ecosystem structure and function. So again, we need to consider this area as a whole, which is what the LTC is doing. Now let's go through the guidelines. So those are the assumptions we make, that we need to monitor or manage the area as a whole, that we need to consider each claim area as essentially being impacted by mining. Now let's talk about the guidelines and rationales that we use to come up with this recommendation of design for APs, or these protected areas. And the first rationale is that the design of these protected areas or areas of particular environmental interest, their design and implementation should fit into the legal mandate of the ISA for managing seabed mining and protecting the environment. And I don't want to dwell on this a lot because we're going to have a number of talks or presentations that discuss the legal framework of this. But basically, if you look through the guidelines of the ISA, their concept of protected areas will be delineated in which no mining will occur to ensure representative and stable biota. There will be preservation reference areas that are large enough so as not to be affected by natural variation of local environmental conditions. The zones should have species composition comparable to that of test mining areas, or presumably of mining areas. And preserve areas should be outside of test mining and areas influenced by the plume. So they need to be beyond the potential impacts of mining. So again, ISA guidelines stipulate that prior to mining and test mining, protected areas should be erected. Protected areas should be designed to sustainably preserve representative biota for all mining claim areas in terms of species composition and biodiversity. The full range of habitat and community types potentially found in mining claim areas should be represented and protected. And finally, the scale of protected areas must be large enough that these community types are stable, i.e. they're sustainable. Stability implies sustainability of ecosystem structure and function. Okay, the second guideline that we follow, so we've designed a set of APs that we fill these first set of legal guidelines from the Seabed Authority. The second guideline or rationale is that all the interests of all stakeholders, including ISA signatories to UNCLOS, nodule mining claim holders, NGOs, the scientific community, should be incorporated into this design. It should be an interactive process as much as possible. And protected areas should be established as soon as possible so that ecosystem-based management, the concepts and principles of ecosystem-based management, can be incorporated into mining strategies and positioning of new claim areas. In order to do effective ecosystem-based management in this region, we can't let the entire region be covered with claims before we start setting up protected areas, because there won't be any space for these APs. Again, so we want to position these protected, one of the guidelines is to position these protected areas or APs in areas not currently claimed, falling within mining claims, and also to consider links among the different components of the ecosystem. We're talking about benthic protected areas, but it's important to recognize that the seafloor community is linked to the water column right up to the surface ocean where primary production occurs. So ecological linkages are important to consider. Let's see. The third guideline is that the protected area system is designed with the following conservation goals. Now, we selected these three primary conservation goals, which are quite generic. They're typical of most environmental management plans in general in marine environments. The first is to preserve representative and unique marine habitats. Second goal is to preserve marine biodiversity in the region and ecosystem structure and function. And finally, the third is to facilitate the management of mining to maintain sustainable, intact, and healthy marine ecosystems. So these are the conservation goals. And they're very standard. They're in agreement with ISA's mandate to protect the marine environment and to manage seabed mining to sustain the ocean environment and resources as a common heritage of mankind, including biological resources on the seafloor. And it also is consistent with general design goals for marine reserves and ecosystem-based management as widely applied. For example, the U.S. National Research Council in 2001 made recommendations that have guidelines that are very similar to this or goals. Convention on Biodiversity makes recommendations that have very similar goals. So this is a very generic and broadly applied set of goals, conservation goals. The fourth rationale is that the CCZ can be divided into three east-west and three north-south strata for conservation management because of strong productivity gradients in ecosystem structure and function from east to west and south to north. And this yields nine distinct subregions within the CCZ, each requiring a protected area. Now, I'm going to spend a little time on this rationale because it's really important. And it's first of all important to recognize that the CCZ, particularly the seafloor, is a food-limited system where there's the food material for the deep sea floor in the abyssal Pacific, as in most parts of the deep sea, is coming from primary production in the surface ocean, becomes attenuated as it sinks into the deep sea, so that it's a very weak signal of production of food material fluxing to the sea floor. And because this food flux is low, the ecosystem structure and function, production, et cetera, are very sensitive to regional differences in the flux of organic matter to the sea floor. And we do know from a variety of studies that the flux of food material to the sea floor, particularly organic carbon flux in the Clipperton Clarion zone, varies regionally. This is a model of export flux, the flux of food material leaving the surface ocean in the CCZ. This is just high is these yellowish colors. Low fluxes are little scale. Flux scale is here from high to low. And the main point is that each of these regions, subregions within that we've identified within this management area of the CCZ has a different level of export flux and productivity. So each of these has a different signal, a different degree of food limitation on community structure and function. Now, this is one study this is the one we used when we had the workshop in 2007. Other studies have come out that show very similar patterns. This is a more sophisticated study, which actually is predicting or estimating the flux of organic carbon or food material at the deep sea floor in the region. And again, this is the management areas we've identified. In each of them, you can see, a south to northward decline in flux of food and from east to west. So, and each of these subregions has a different level of productivity than adjacent regions. So there is strong reason to believe that ecosystem structure and function in each of these regions is different. Now, why do we care about the flux? Perhaps I'm beating a dead horse here, but it turns out that many aspects of ecosystem structure and function in deep sea ecosystems are controlled by the availability of food or the flux of particular organic carbon. For example, the abundance of megafauna, larger animals, the abundance of macrofaunal biomass, intermediate-sized animals, their biomass is strongly correlated with the flux. This is POC flux versus a normalized value of these parameters in the abyssal ocean, including the CCZ. Macrofaunal abundance, there are over 100 points here, so these would drown out the rest of the figure if I put the points on, but there's a strong correlation. Oh, having trouble hitting the button here. Nematode biomass, another ecosystem structural component. Microbial biomass, sediment community, oxygen consumption, rates of sediment mixing by animals, depths of sediment mixing by animals. In fact, just about every aspect of ecosystem structure and function that you can measure in abyssal ecosystems are strongly controlled or strongly correlated with the flux of food. And if we look at the range, the difference of the range of fluxes of food flux at the seafloor across the CCZ from the least to the most, we see that that it falls right in this area where there's strong modulation of the community structure and function by flux of organic carbon. So this is an important environmental parameter to consider in our stratification of the Clipperton and Clarion zone. Actually, I probably made this, but this is just data actually from the CCZ showing that macrofaunal abundance within the CCZ, if you take many points, is strongly correlated with chlorophyll A concentration in the surface ocean, which is an index of productivity and export of food to the seafloor. It's also important to note that this is the Clipperton Clarion zone has a surprising diversity of fauna. I had a little conversation with Charles Morgan on the plane coming in, and he said it's all worms. We need to preserve the worms. Well, it isn't just worms. It turns out there are lots of very interesting organisms that are larger than worms, things that Dave doesn't really care about worms. He cares about things like giant sea cucumbers that are half a meter long, blind fish, Dumbo, octopus. There is a remarkable diversity of animals in this region. Within a small area, you can find a few square kilometers, more than 20 different species of megafauna that are very unusual. They're adapted to live in the abyssal environment. You won't encounter them walking around in the streets here in Jamaica. The macrofauna also has very high diversity. I'm not going to dwell on this, but if you take one square meter of sediment, which looks pretty monotonous, uninteresting to us, you'll get over 100 species of macrofaunal animals and probably many more species of copepods, the kinds of animals that Pedro Martinez studies and we'll talk about. Now, it turns out that this diversity of animals changes regionally across the CCZ. From our studies, we've sampled three locations in the east, the middle, and the west in the Clipperton Clarion zone. And these are each in a different productivity regime. And we find a substantially different fauna in the east, the center, and the west. In fact, whole families of polychaete worms are abundant in the east, and they're gone. They disappear in the west, which means that the fauna is turning over. As far as we can, to the best of our measurement abilities, the fauna changes, the species structure changes from east to middle to west. And certainly, almost certainly, it'll change from north to south because we're quite convinced this is driven by the productivity gradients. You see similar patterns in other components of the fauna, including the foraminifera and at the species level with polychaete worms. Okay, rationale 5 is that the boundaries of the protected areas, or these APs, should be straight lines to facilitate rapid recognition by all parties. This is actually a basic fundamental principle of protected area design. It seems very logical. I won't dwell on it. The 6th rationale is that the core of each area should be at least 200 kilometers in length and width, i.e. large enough to maintain minimal sustainable population sizes for most of the species that are potentially restricted to a subregion of the CCZ. Now, this guideline, a recommendation, is based on a lot of work, hundreds or dozens of modeling studies and hundreds of studies of marine protected areas. There's a lot of literature, scientific literature behind this that I don't have time to go into, but basically summarizing what this literature says is that if we assume that animals leaving a protected area are likely to die because of influences from mining, that's how we have to manage mining on a large, or the CCZ on a large scale, to promote sustainable populations, the size of these areas, APs, has to be large enough that animals on average can recruit or maintain sustainable populations within one of these protected areas. Now, for adult species that don't move very much, or adults of species that don't move very much, you don't need a very big area for fish or small worms that don't move around as adults. Then you probably a few square kilometers would be, or 10 kilometers on a side would be enough. But it turns out that most animals, most benthic animals, or many benthic animals in marine environments, have a what's called the larval dispersal stage. They produce larvae that go up into the water column and can be transported long distances. And if we look at all the data that are available from marine environments, we can see that for most marine benthos have larvae that disperse less than 100 kilometers. This is the full range of data for a whole for larval dispersal scales for a broad range of species. This is estimated dispersal distance. In general, things disperse 100 kilometers or less. And the rule from that has been developed from marine protected area design theory and practice and empirical studies is that you need to have a protected area that's at least twice the average dispersal distance of the animals living from which you want to maintain sustainable populations, which says an area of a size of 200 kilometers on a side. If half the area dispersal distance is 100 kilometers, if one dispersal distance is 100 kilometers, twice that distance is 200 kilometers. So you need an area, relatively large area, that's 200 kilometers on a side. Now, it's also important to note that if you have protected areas this size, the average distance between these protected areas is not too much different from the average size of the areas, which means that if an animal does disperse, can disperse far enough to go beyond the boundaries of this marine protected area, there's a pretty good likelihood that some of its larvae will end up landing in another protected area, have the potential to disperse to the next protected area. So what is, in essence, what you would like to do in your design exercise is to minimum the gap, the zone where a larvae can fall in between these different spatial scales. You want to minimize the gap between the within size of a marine protected area and the between size, the scale of an individual area versus the distance between areas. And this is maybe not a completely intuitive concept, but I can explain it to you in more detail later. Another important principle here is that it's good to have variable spacing, not everything spacing the same distance. And it's almost impossible to put marine protected areas of this size within this region with the given claim areas without having variable spacing. Okay. But the way this is set up, these are recommendations set up an MPA design system that can function as a network where there can be sustainability largely within protected areas but also dispersal between them. Almost done here. Rationale 7 is that each protected area should contain the full range of habitats within a subregion. This includes abyssal plains and hills with and without nodules, seamounts, fracture zones if they're in one of these subregions, et cetera. And it does take some planning to get a protected area to encompass all of these habitats. But a 200 by 200 kilometer area actually is integrating over enough habitat variability within each of these regions that it's actually quite likely that all the different habitat features or types of habitats can be captured within an AP or a protected area of this size. The last guideline/rationale we use is that each protected area should be surrounded by a buffer zone of about 100 kilometers in width. to ensure that benthic communities in the core of this zone are not affected by mining plumes. Now, there's been quite a bit of work. There have been empirical studies and modeling studies of plume distributions. And also, there has been quite a bit of work about the physical oceanographic transport regime in abyssal areas in the CCZ. And the bottom line is that if you look at these modeling studies and dilutions of plumes, the benthic impacts of plumes from a mining operation are likely to be restricted to scales of less than 100 kilometers, less than equal to 100 kilometers. This is for benthic ecologic impacts, based on our best knowledge to date. That we're not talking about effects in the water column, which could be broader, but we're talking about benthic effects at this point. So they're likely to be restricted to a distance of less than 100 kilometers. So if you put a buffer zone of 100 kilometers around the core protected area, then in principle this area should be protected from the deleterious effects of a mining operation. Okay, so the summary of these recommendations then, and when you put this all together again, is that there are 9 400 by 400 square kilometer areas, one each in each of these 9 ecological subregions that are designed to catch different levels of productivity and different kinds of fauna within the region. These APs or protected areas should be situated to avoid or minimize overlap with existing mining exploration reserve claim areas. They should protect a representative set of seamounts in the region. There are seamounts, and as you'll hear from Malcolm Clark, seamounts have a characteristic fauna. So these need to be considered in the siting of these protected areas. This is one option that we've suggested. Again, this is a flexible strategy subject to negotiation and improved knowledge of ecological characteristics and biogeographic and characteristics of the region. But this is one suggestion. There are a variety of different scenarios or different distributions of these protected areas within each of these subregions that I think would be acceptable. And again, it's important to have input from all the stakeholders and how these are sited. It's important to capture the full range of habitats within each of these, one of these protected areas. And it's also important to recognize that this is viewed as an adaptive management, part of an adaptive management strategy, that the intent is not that these protected areas are located here and then cast in stone forever. As we improve our knowledge of how the fauna is distributed, how the resources are distributed, where miners might want to go, as new mine claims come in, these areas, protected areas, could be moved following consideration by the appropriate experts, so that this is part of an adaptive management strategy. It's important to begin at this point with a management plan, but again, this can evolve as we learn more about the environment and better understand the distribution of knowledgeable resources in the region. Okay, so the strengths of this approach is it's based on sound conservation and management principles. It protects about 30% of the Clipperton Clarion Zone, which optimizes conservation and sustainability benefits. And there are many, many references supporting this now, this 30% or more area. It manages the Clipperton Clarion Zone conservation as a whole, facilitating cooperation in selecting and monitoring protected areas, cooperation among mining claimants, the ISA, the scientific community, NGOs. So it facilitates collaboration in selecting and monitoring of protected areas, and also in maintenance of biodiversity and ecosystem structure and function across the region. And it also implementing a plan like this would help to keep the ISA, I think, in the leadership globally in responsible environmental management of human extractive activities at the seafloor. Okay, I'll stop there. Are there any questions? This again, just to show Charles that it's not just worms down there. There are some really cool animals. This always reminds me of something from the bar scene from the original Star Wars movie, somebody you might encounter. There's also something funny about this picture, but I won't tell you what it is. This yeah, you have to ask David. Okay, any questions? I don't have any idea whether I went too long or not. I probably did, but do I have time for questions? Yep. Charles? Oh, Pedro.
Hello, Craig. This 30% coverage, this was a target of your study, or this was a result of your design? And why not more?
It was both. Why not more?
Yeah.
Well, there, from in terms of conservation benefits, it's hard to argue. 30%, actually, I'll show you why. Thought somebody might ask. Could we turn off that light for a second back there? Because you can't see this. But actually, this slide doesn't show up very much. But if you, I don't know if you can see this. I changed the background. But basically, there's a trade-off between there occurs. If you protect too much of an area, especially from fisheries, then you decrease fishery yields. An asymptotic increase in biodiversity protection as you increase the percentage of an area protected, but there's a decrease in the exploitation of sustainable biomass. If you protect too much of an area, then you protect too much of the resource, and it can't be used. So there actually, if you protect too much of the area, then it doesn't leave resources available to be extracted or exploited by human activities. If you protect too little, then you don't. There's too much extinction. There's not large enough area of the habitat, large enough proportion of the habitats protected to maintain biodiversity. So there's actually a sweet spot between 30% and 50%, depending on the studies that have been done. So if you protect too much, you defeat the purposes of trying to have a sustainable extractive activities in the region. And that's why. And that was both a goal and an outcome, that we were aiming at something on the order of 30%.
I just feel obligated to point out that while you were fooling around with worms with Professor Hessler at Scripps, I was working with Dave Pawson at the Smithsonian to identify several new species of holothurians out there. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Charles. Malcolm has a question, and then we'll come back to Pedro. And I will try to speak slower also. I suddenly realize I'm speaking very quickly.
Craig, a quick question about one of the, I've forgotten whether it was a principle or a guideline. The issue of avoiding the claimant areas in the location of an MPA area, basically the minimizing the overlap. The issue that comes up there is that if the claimant areas cover the regions of high manganese abundance, manganese nodule abundance, then in fact taking the MPAs outside that area is protecting a different type of habitat. I guess we'll hear more about that in talks coming up in terms of the overall distribution within the CCZ of the manganese habitat. But it's just this general conservation issue that by avoiding the claimant areas, we may in fact not be protecting the type of communities that are going to be most impacted by mining.
I think that's a possibility. My personal opinion and based what I've seen in the both working in the area and from the geological mapping, et cetera, is that the claim areas are based on the largest extents of the best resources. And I think a good question to ask the people that, for example, Charles Morgan, is whether there's reason to believe that there aren't smaller patches that are similar nodule coverage and even maybe similar geochemical characteristics outside of the claim areas, but they're not in claim areas because they haven't been detected or they're too small to be of commercial interest. The basic question is fundamentally, do we think that the claim areas now already capture the unique characteristics of the mineral resource distribution? I think the answer to that question is no, but that's a really important question to ask. And maybe Charles, do you, or does anyone else want to comment on that?
I think I have to agree with you. We don't really know, but it is clear that these deposits are very patchy and very widespread, and it would be extremely unlikely that all the claims capture all of this similar kind of environment. Right. But you're right. I mean, it has to be quantified. Yeah. I don't think there's any question about that.
But that actually kind of raises the issue that if we wait too long to do this, it may be that as more claim areas come in, as they cover more of the area, they will capture all of that potentially unique habitat. The longer we wait in beginning to set up a set of protected areas, the more likely we are to have to displace a claim in order to protect a particular kind of habitat.
Craig, before I pass across to Sabine for a different topic, in relation to this has been something that the Legal and Technical Commission have also discussed, in that in trying to cite the various API EIs in the various regions, we're sort of being forced a little bit around the edges rather than putting something in the middle. But there are opportunities of putting APEIs within and around where the claim areas are, maybe where there are more typical, if you like, nodule fields and things. But what we would have to break, if you like, the principle we would have to break in that case was the 4x400 square, that they could be smaller and maybe a different shape to fit within a region. Is there any reason why that 400x400 should not be broached, if you like, as a guiding principle, if it makes sense for actually putting APEIs in a better regional framework?
It actually does make sense not to break it, because the length scale of impact from the plumes is on the order of 100 kilometers, and that's not going away. We can't change that, I don't think, in reality. And if you have a 100-kilometer buffer zone, then you limit, species cannot get into the core of that unless they can distribute more than 100 kilometers. And if you have a core area that's much smaller than 200 kilometers, it's no longer self-sustainable for species that that may disperse on that intermediate scale. So there is a limit to how small you can make these and have a sustainable system that functions both sustainably within or is connected between. And those constraints are locked in by the existing scale of these mining claim areas. They're on the order of hundreds of kilometers across. So you're already, from the dispersal perspective, you're locked into a scale of 100 kilometers in order to maintain sustainability. Now, what I would recommend in a situation like that is that you set up these nine areas, but then you might also have smaller areas interspersed in between that fulfill some of that function of protecting habitat. Characteristic habitats. The other interesting thing to think about, I wasn't sure if I should show this or not, but there has been an independent group set of recommendations that came out from a group funded by UNESCO, Virginie T. Lowe et al. And this is their plan. Their plan actually is in red boxes. Ours are in black boxes. And their plan is virtually identical to ours in the general scheme. They have slightly different siting based on geological characteristics. They don't have anything in these lower two areas because they don't consider this as part of the management area. If they did, they would include boxes in here too. So this is actually based on geological, to a large degree on geological characteristics. And it's interesting, it's very similar. So the concept is virtually identical. The precise siting is a little different. But still in my mind, I think setting up this scheme with these protected areas and nine strata is much more important than the fine details of the siting. I think the fine details of the location is each of these probably will change over time. We need to build in that flexibility, but locking in the concept that you have this scale of protection, I think, is incredibly important at this time. That's my opinion. Pedro has the microphone.
Oh, you got